In part one, I explained the plan for my exhaust system, made a wall opening for the pipes, and made and mounted a cover for the opening. Before I can lay the tubes under the ceiling, I need some blast gates. Blast gates are needed to lock the different exits of the extraction system to concentrate the suction caused by the airflow on one exit. Such a blast gate consists of three parts: an upper plate, a lower plate, and a slider in between. The two plates each have circular cutouts into which the tubes engage. The slider in between also gets a round cutout. And of course an impermeable part to be able to shut off. To be on the safe side, I measure the outer diameter of the tubes once again and then adjust my circular cutter. Then I mount the stub to the drilling machine and adjust it to the appropriate distance to the circle cutter, about 26 mm. The circle cutter cuts the 110 mm diameter of the pipes. Left and right, I'll leave 26 mm space, so the total diameter is 162 mm. Because the individual parts are cut out of a plate, I first cut a strip from the plate, which has the width of the individual parts, so 162 mm. Then I just slice the strips into pieces and get all pieces with the same width guaranteed, and have less work at the same time. So I set the rib fence of the table saw to 162 mm and cut a few strips. The cutting to length is done with a miter saw. The circle cutter needs a small sacrificial board under the workpiece so that its cutting blades do not get into the aluminum table of the drilling machine. And as I had to find out, the drilling machine is literally pulling itself into the workpiece, which means you have to clamp it properly. I want to apologize for the noise my neighbor made with his saw, for my request not to be so loud when I'm in my workshop. He unfortunately had no understanding. The upper and lower part of the blast gate are already finished with that, but the slider is still missing. It can be a bit thinner because no tubes will be attached to it later. All parts are then sanded smooth so that they can slide past each other easily. I made a mistake with the sliding parts and put the circle too close to the edge, flush with the case. A small overhang is needed where a stopper can be glued on and where you can grab the slider to open it. Therefore, I cut the parts again, this time with a little space. From the same material, I cut a few thin strips which I glue onto the plates. The slider must be between the strips so that the distance is exactly right, but there is the danger to glue it down. I tried different variations to avoid this. On the one hand, by precise and careful gluing so that no glue gets into the inside. On the other hand, by masking the slider. Both variants work equally fine. that was a little too tight for the sliders. I thought if I cut the sides out of the same plane as the slider, there should be just enough space to fit them, but the tolerances are too small to get them in between. That means I have to plane and sand the sliders flat again. The engineer speaks here of a clearance fit. In the next step, I cut the sides again to create a smooth outer edge over the three layers. It wasn't about making the blast gate smaller, so I tried to remove as little material as possible. And then I can glue the stoppers onto the sliders. They later give me a defined stop that assures me that the opening is exactly right. I want to fix the tubes to the ceiling later. On wooden beams this is no problem, but a large part will run along under this double T steel beam. I can't and I don't want to just screw into it, so I built some holders around it to guide the pipe safely. They should consist of a small multiplex board with a hole large enough for the tubes to pass through. The lower part should be removable to be able to insert the tubes and be held by screws. The upper part should wrap around the steel beam with angles and hold onto it without being screwed down to the beam, so the holders only hang under the beam. I still have some 30mm plywood leftovers, which are perfectly suitable for this. The only problem was that 30mm are too thick to be penetrated by a circle cutter in one pass, so you have to cut up to the half of it, then turn the piece around and finish the hole from the other side. The central drill of the circular cutter is therefore also long enough, so that from the other side you have at least a guide hole to which you can orient yourself. And in order to fight the dust already now, without an extraction system, I have fixed my vacuum cleaner next to the drilling machine, in order to collect a part of the sawdust directly. The holders were unnecessarily long on one side, so I shortened them again here. Then I pre-drilled the holes for the screws. Without them, the multiplex would split up and it will be easier to find the right position later. Of course, the holes are countersunk, and because the screws are longer than my drill bit, I use them to create a small passage before I divide the holders in the middle of the hole. Then I screw them together again so that nothing gets lost. These small angles are now to be attached to the holders. Therefore, I clamp the holders directly together with the angles on the steel beam and screw them together. Due to the clamping, the angles press tight against the steel beam and the holder sits backlash free without wobbling under the carrier. In the meantime, the blast skates have dried as well. I scrape off any excess glue. I can start with attaching the tubes. Where the tubes run along a wooden beam, I fix them with some plumber tape. There is a special lubricant to make it easier to put the tubes together, but it is still not easy. I would rather say without it, it's practically impossible and with bloody annoying and exhausting. You have to hit exactly the right angle and then they suddenly slip together. But finding this right angle is a real test of patience. You should try to avoid 90 degree angles with the tubes and replace them with the largest possible arc, or at least two 45 degree angles. Either serves to slow down the airflow as little as possible, and a tight 90 degree curve does slow down the airflow quite a bit. Pipe under the steel beam I attached here a bit too fast, because I could not insert the angle pieces this way. By the way, I also installed it the wrong way around, but I only noticed that when I was almost finished. I should have noticed it at the branch at least, because it points in the wrong direction. So I had to do everything twice. An old lamp was getting in the way, but because it was out of order for years, I removed it completely. When I was finished with it, I noticed that the branch is flipped around. Sometimes it helps to clear your head for a moment and to deal with something else, because you don't see the obvious things when you are stuck too deep into something. Holzmann mallet is, by the way, not helpful at all to connect the pipes. Contrary to my original plan, I decided to add a branch over the floor extraction to make it easier to collect the dust from my belt sander. Because the pipes are a bit under tension here, I reinforced the connection with installation adhesive. I hope that the tubes will give way over time and take on their enforced shape. Now all the blast gates and tubes are in place. The next part will be about the on-off switch, blast meters behind the blast gates, and the floor extraction.